introduce Professor Claudio Lopez-Guerra, and I'm not rolling the R's because I can't. But he is an associate professor of political studies at CIDA in Mexico City. He's visiting us now where he, from Princeton, where he's a visiting research fellow for the year, and his family drove up all the way from Mexico City. He works in normative democratic theory with a focus on institutional design and the immoral evaluation of political institutions. His most recent publications include a book by Oxford University Press titled Democracy and Disenfranchisement, The Morality of Electoral Exclusions, 2014. And he's also published in journals such as the Journal of Political Philosophy, Politics, Philosophy and Economics, and Social Theory and Practice. And he's currently working on a book titled that's very similar to what the talk that he's presenting to you today. So I'm sure he would value any feedback that you have. So please join me in welcoming.
Well, good evening. Thank you for being here. It's a great opportunity for me to present this work to you. I want to thank in particular Professor Riddle for inviting me. So it's great, thank you. Let's get started. So I'm going to be talking about a problem that I think is very significant, both in theory and practice, but that has not received sufficient philosophical attention, surprisingly. So to introduce this subject, let me tell you two recent stories. In an event at Georgetown University a few months ago, with other scholars, among them Robert Putnam, perhaps you know who he is, President Obama had a conversation on social justice, and at some point, he claimed that when those who are in a privileged position in society withdraw from the commons by, for instance, sending their kids to private schools and by going to private gyms to work out as opposed to public parks, they contribute in a way to broadening the inequality of opportunity that we observe today in American society. Now, at that point, it hardly needed any reminding that President Obama's daughters attend one of the most prestigious private school in the country. The second story concerns President of Argentina, Cristina Kirchner. In a public event some years ago, she was praising her deceased husband, also a former president of Argentina, for having at some point chosen to get himself attended at a public hospital rather than a private hospital. And during this event, she claimed that there is no public healthcare system unless presidents get attended in public hospitals. All else is a pure sham, that's what she claimed. Now, sometime later, President Kirchner fell ill, and surprise, surprise, she attended one of the most prestigious private hospitals in Argentina. Now, of course, in both of these cases, the media, especially, of course, the adversaries of these two presidents, immediately pointed out that they were hyper. And this would have been the approach that most moral and political philosophers would have adopted in assessing the behavior of these individuals, right? So on the one hand, they praise the importance of the public provision of certain services, but on the other hand, they personally do not use those services. I do not want to focus here on whether these two individuals did anything wrong in these cases, which would be the traditional focus, as I just mentioned. The question I want to address is whether there is anything to be said in favor of the idea that their remarks were trying to convey. whether there is anything to say for the idea that those who make public policy, those who make the most important decisions in a polity, should have a larger stake in those decisions. So this is the problem I'm going to be talking about today. I'm calling it the problem of justice in decision bearing. So, as opposed to what? Well, in political philosophy, we often focus on what justice requires at the level of decision-making institutions, right? So how equal or unequal are we in political terms, in the process of making decisions? Do we have equal voting rights? Do we have equal speech rights? And so on. That is not the problem I want to focus. I want to focus on this different, unexplored problem, which has to do with how equal we are at the level of experiencing public decisions, at the level of suffering or experiencing the workings of the state. Now, here's a more precise definition of what I have in mind. So as you know, what rulers do in office affects the basic interests of millions. Yet, their own basic interests are not at stake. Rulers are, in significant respects, immune to their own performance in office. Think about it for a moment. They determine the quality of the public healthcare system, quality of public hospitals. And yet, whenever they have a problem, they are allowed to, and they normally can, get attended in private hospitals. They are responsible also for the quality of the public education system. And yet, they are allowed to, and they do, send their kids to private schools. They are also responsible for the state of the legal justice system, the administration of justice. And yet, whenever they have a problem, they get the best Ivy League educated lawyers to represent them, whereas ordinary citizens do not have that option, and sometimes just have to make use of a public defender. So the question is this just? Can anything be said for the idea that rulers should have a larger stake in their own decisions? My thesis, that is to say, my answer to that question is yes. Rulers ought to have skin in the game. There ought to be a more robust communion of interest between the rulers and the ruled. This is a way of saying that rulers ought to cast their lot with the ruled. They have to be in the same boat. I am calling this ideal the idea of equality of stakes, which, as I just mentioned, is a conception of justice in decision-bearing as opposed to justice in decision-making. Okay, so although it is a neglected topic, some people at some times have touched on this problem of justice in decision-bearing. So consider this quote from Federalist 57. So let me read it out loud. Representatives can make no law which will not have its full operation on themselves and their friends, as well as on the great mass of the society. This has always been deemed one of the strongest bonds by which human policy can connect the rulers and the people together. It creates between them that communion of interests and sympathy of sentiments of which few governments have furnished examples. So there's an idea here I want to rescue, the idea of creating a communion of interests between rulers and the ruled. Now, this idea, broadly egalitarian idea, can be understood in two different ways. One way is what I call a minimalist conception of communion of interests, which involves basically the notion of equality of legal subjection. So what this means is basically what we saw in that quote from the Federalists. It would be obviously unjust if members of Congress pass the law, for instance, establishing weaker punishments for them if they were to commit a certain crime, as opposed to the punishments that would apply for all other citizens, right? If they were to create a legal system that would apply only to them, that would be more relaxed, let's say, less strict, compared to the legal system that would prevail for everyone else, that would obviously be unjust. But this is too undemanding, I believe. So what is at stake here is merely that we should not have the kind of system that prevailed before the modern democratic revolutions as we, the kind of system that prevailed in our traditional aristocratic societies. And the creation of representative government was supposed to bring about this communion of interests. So think about the traditional democratic story that we tell ourselves all the time. So citizens have the right to appoint who's going to rule us. Right? Citizens vote for representatives. Therefore, presumably, they're going to choose individuals who are, in the first place, disposed to promote the interests of the government. They're going to promote the public interest and not their own interest. And if they happen not to do so, then the voters would react and they would throw the rascals out. And this would create an effective communion of interests. Now, that's a very nice story. But unfortunately, when we look at the reality of modern representative systems and modern democracies, the fact is that there is no such communion of interests. They do not, rulers and rulers do not have the same things or interests at stake. What happens if a politician fails to fulfill his moral duty to create a more just society? He would probably, perhaps, maybe, get voted out of office. What is that? Basically, just a professional setback. It's just a professional cost. It's not his or her basic interests that are at stake. Now think about what is at stake for millions of people in the performance of governmental powers. We're talking about their basic interests of persons. We're talking about their life chances, whether they would have the opportunity to get a decent education, whether they would have the opportunity to get decent healthcare, or they would have the opportunity to flourish as human beings. Political power is an extremely important kind of power. And what is at stake there, of course, is of huge importance. Whereas for politicians, there isn't that much at stake in that regard. There is no such communion of interests, really. So that is why I want to put forward a different conception of what the communion of interests entails, a conception that is more robust, which I am calling equality of stakes. So the idea here, again, as I explained, is that rulers ought to have skin in the game on a footing of equality with the random citizen. So what would this entail exactly? Perhaps up to this point, all or most of you are saying, well, yes, that sounds plausible. I mean, intuitively, there's not much to object, right, to the idea of making politicians having a larger stake in their own performance in office. But when we think about different ways of trying to implement that idea, things become a little bit more complicated. So let's see what a radical proposal to bring about equality of stakes would look like. So consider this scheme that I call pilotage responsibility. Imagine that we push for this kind of institutional reform. As a condition for the occupancy of high public office, politicians and their dependents, for the duration of their term and beyond, will be required to reside within the polity, and if they seek out a certain service, they would be randomly appointed to a public provider, say a public hospital, a public school, a public defender, and so on. Now let me explain a few of these elements. Why the requirement of living in the polity? Now, consider what's at stake right now in terms of the responsibilities of public officials. They could rule, or let's say misrule, a polity, and not only they would be allowed to have these privileges of sending their kids to private schools or to get them in private hospitals, there's no requirement for them to actually live in the country. They could just create a mess and then leave. We do have requirements for occupying public office, residency requirements for occupying public office. You have to live in a certain place for some time before being able to be elected to office. But we don't have ex post requirements that would request rulers to submit minimally to the effects of whatever they do in office. So that is the logic behind this condition. But more radically, the core of this proposal or this scheme is the random appointment to public services. Why random appointment to public services? Well, because otherwise we can imagine politicians being able to channel resources to certain public schools, or certain public hospitals that they know they would be able to attend. So that would be a way of getting around the ideal of equality of states. So just imagine for a moment what this entails. If you're familiar, vaguely familiar, I don't know, with John Rawls's work on justice, perhaps you've heard the idea of a bill of ignorance. This idea consists of trying to put ourselves in a position that others would suffer. So the idea is that when you're making a decision determining what conditions are going to prevail in a society, you don't know what your specific characteristics are so that you cannot adopt institutions that would benefit that decision. So behind a bill of ignorance, you do not know whether you belong to an advantaged or disadvantaged group in society. So you are forced to focus on the least advantaged members of society. So this creates a sort of artificial bill of ignorance in this sense, right? So the idea is simply, look, I don't know to which public hospital I'm going to have to go the next time I get sick. So if I'm in charge of the public healthcare system, I want to make sure that my chances of getting a good attention are good, even if the procedure is random, right? So that's the idea. Now, there will be many practical difficulties in carrying something like this, putting something like this into practice. But it is a way of imagining what the kind of radical demands that the ideal of equality of states would be making on public officers. Why do I call it pilotage responsibility? As you might know, in the history of political thought, as all, you know, from Plato to contemporary thinkers, we find time and again a comparison between the steering of ships and the ruling of states, right? So rulers are the captains that have a duty to take the boat to a safe port. Now the problem I have been discussing so far is that captains today actually have their own private emergency boats, so to speak. They're not really in the same boat with the rest of the population. So I think a better analogy would be the idea of the pilots of an airplane. In that case, whenever an airplane goes down, there's no way the captains can do, and the pilots can do anything for themselves that they could not do for the rest of the population, but for the rest of the passengers. If the plane goes down, they go down with it. They have full, equal skin in the game. And actually, tell me just an actual story. In World War II, was often a requirement for mechanics to go on the test flight after repairing an aircraft to make sure that they had really paid attention to what they were doing while repairing the aircraft. So this is just a metaphor, a way of describing this ideal of quality of stakes. So what can we say for something like this? And what can we say against it? So what kind of objections can one raise against adopting a system like this? Let me mention one at the beginning, which is important to clarify. So you might think, well, this would be obviously very problematic limitation of the freedom of public officials. They can't send their kids to private schools, they can't go to public hospitals, they can't get their own private lawyers. That sounds pretty bad in terms of, you know, the rights to choose those things. However, it's important for you to notice that they wouldn't be forced to do so. These would be conditions for occupying public office. Nobody is forced to pursue public office, right? So if you are going to take seriously the responsibilities of exercising political power in the interest of the governed, then you know what you're up for. And you voluntarily take on these duties. What I'm trying here to do, in a way, is to really rescue the significance of exercising political power. So in our times, we often think of it as simply a right that can be, that comes with no duties, right? Anyone, we all have the right to run for office, we all have the right to pursue political power, and that's it. But when we think of it as we should, that is, as a very important fiduciary obligation, the sole purpose of political power is to advance the interests of the governed. That's what it is for. It is not power that can be used to advance the interests of those who have it. So, when we see it in that way, all this comes together. So, what is the argument for this? I want to say that we can make two different kinds of arguments for the ideal of quality of stakes. The first is an instrumental argument, that is to say, it is a device, a useful device, to bring about good or just results. And the second argument is that it is in itself a requirement of justice. It is in itself a just institution that we should be pursuing. Okay? Now let me just clarify that this is a pro-tanto argument. What I mean by this is that it could be overridden by certain kinds of considerations. It only means that we should presume that there should be a presumption in favor of requiring rulers to have skin in the game, perhaps in a radical way, as in the system of pilotage responsibility. But there may be other considerations, some of which I will talk about in a moment, that might make us think that all things considered, perhaps we shouldn't go and just trying to establish it just yet. But making a pro-tempo argument is nevertheless important because it allows us to see the kind of duties that public officials have that they are not currently even modestly striving to fulfill. So first, let me say a little bit more about the instrumental argument, although not that much, because I have, I think, already conveyed the general idea. So what is the instrumental argument? Why would we expect more just policies and laws in a society that adopts a system of equality of states, such as pilotage responsibility? Well, again, since their own fate, the fate of decision makers, would be tied to the fate of the random citizen, rulers would be strongly motivated to make the state provide better basic services. And in that way, it would promote justice. And looking after their own interests, they would promote the public interests, just as the pilots of an airplane have a very strong interest in making sure that the plane arrives and lands safely. So I won't say more about the instrumental argument, except just to mention that there are countervailing considerations. Perhaps, as I've heard some people say, for instance, well, perhaps it's not always good to have politicians and rulers who are so invested in their own decisions, where they have so much skin in the game. Perhaps because they might, as a result, make hasty decisions. So let me just give you an example. Consider the case of a surgeon, a very distinguished, a very good surgeon, a brain surgeon, who happens to have a child with a tumor. Now, there might be good reasons to have someone else take the tumor out, even though why? Precisely because this surgeon has too much skin in the game. It's his own son or daughter. And having so much at stake, that might lead him not to perform at his very best. So it could be argued that, for instance, politicians were suddenly required to attend public hospitals, they might suddenly be pushing for a healthcare reform of very big proportions that would be designed not with sufficient care, not with the sufficient attention. So in the end, perhaps the outcome might be bad. So this is a kind of counter-argument to the logic I'm pushing here. I don't think it is not a counter-argument that is decisive, but it is the kind of thing that, well, me or anyone who is interested in an idea like this would have to think about, you know, in terms of making sure that something like this would work. Now, as I said, I believe that we can also contend that the ideal of equality of states is itself, independently of the kind of consequences or results that it would produce, it's itself a requirement of justice. So the idea here would be that rulers have an accountability-based duty of justice to have skin in the game. So this is an outline of the argument that I have in mind. So the first premise I take it to be fairly uncontroversial. I think you would all agree that as a matter of justice, rulers ought to be accountable. They owe it to us, to those who are ruled by them, to provide us with the necessary elements to evaluate whether they have performed their duties of promoting the public interest. We have to be able to scrutinize the decisions that they make. So I think that is fairly controversial, and you would all agree with that. Now, the second premise in the argument is that the idea, the very idea of accountability, requires what I am calling equality of stakes. Now, that part of the argument, the second element, might not be so clear. So let me explain what I mean. So think about the standard mechanisms of accountability in democratic systems. One is the mechanism of electoral accountability. On this idea, voters are able to evaluate and scrutinize what rulers do in office, how well they perform in office, simply by living under their rule. That is to say, by being in the polity, in our daily life experience, we can tell whether things are going on, whether things are going well with the economy, whether things are well in other respects, so we get a sense of how well they're performing. And then voting time comes, and then we cast a vote, and that's it. That is the traditional idea of electoral accountability. Now, of course, this is a very unsatisfactory notion, or limited notion, of accountability. Because just by our daily experience, we can't really get an adequate understanding of whether rulers are fulfilling their duties to create a just society or not. We get some sense of it, sure, but not a full sense. We need, democratic theorists tell us, something more, something that they call deliberate accountability. We have to be able to listen to the reasons that rulers give in support of the policies and the laws that they are establishing. We have to be able to consider the reasons for their actions and their behavior. Otherwise, just by looking at their results, it would not be enough. Okay, so far so good. What I'm saying is that deliberate accountability is not enough either. Just having mechanisms that force decision makers to tell us, to explain to us, to justify their actions to us, is not enough. Why not? Well, here's the reason. There are many things from the performance of office, from public officers, that we cannot observe and that are very relevant for our evaluation of them. We cannot observe their efforts. They can tell us, I did my best, but how can we know? We cannot observe their motives. They tell us, I had only the best interests of the public in mind. But how can we know? We cannot observe these things. And we cannot observe what they claim to us that would happen or would have happened had they not behaved the way that they behaved. That is, there are many counterfactuals involved. Look, so the economy is not doing well. That's true, the politician would have to admit. But you know, it's doing the best it can, given the circumstances. I did the best for the economy to prosper. If I hadn't done what I did, things would be worse. How do you refute that counterfactual? You can invite all the Nobel Prizes in economics to decide the issue, and you will immediately realize that they disagree. And they disagree because social sciences are not in a position to be able to tell us this is the best policy or in these circumstances, and these are going to be the effects if you adopt this policy, and these are going to be the effects if you adopt this other policy. The social world is a complex world, and we cannot, in a clear, direct way, refute the claims and excuses that politicians make all the time. Right? So the economy is as good as it can be. Or, no, wait, I know it's not good, but just wait a little, it's going to get better. Of course, that is if those who replace me in office don't screw things up. Or, you know, perhaps they're not perfect, but they're better than they would be if you had voted for the other guys. So these counterfactuals are very difficult to refute in a clear way. Now think about it for a moment. Let me give you an example. So in my country, I'm from Mexico, was born and raised in Mexico City. In my country, every year, 10,000 persons, mostly children, die from lack of adequate nutrition. Now, why aren't politicians in Mexico behind bars for that result? Of course, we have mechanisms to send to jail those who clearly abuse political power. You steal money, if you gravely break the law or the constitution, and you can be processed and sent to jail, right? Why don't we have a mechanism that punishes politicians for these grave social injustices that we see all the time, for people lacking adequate access to education, to public healthcare, to healthcare, to legal representation, to housing, and so on? Why? Well, because they can tell us these stories that we cannot systematically refute, precisely because of the state of social sciences. So at this point, one can say, well, too bad. That's all we can do. There's nothing else we can do. Yes, well, that's politics. It's an imperfect world. That's it. But my point, this is the idea of point number two, is that's not true. There is another way, another form of accountability, not that replaces the other two, electoral accountability and deliberative accountability, but that supplements it, and that it is required by justice precisely because the other two are insufficient. And this form of accountability involves casting your lot with the ruled. Right? So it is a form of accounting. Look, I am telling you, imagine a politician sincerely believing he has done the best for their subjects, for her subjects. These are all, here are all the reasons why I adopted and voted for these policies and so on. Now, I understand that I can't prove to you that they are in your own good. But the best I can do is to show you, look, I'm in it with you. I'm in the same boat. I have my own skin in the game. That's my proof to you that I did my best to advance your interests. If we succeed, we succeed or fail together, we are in a communion of interests. And if, by the first point, it is a requirement of justice for rulers, for persons in a position of power that is so important morally, to be accountable, then they ought to take, that's my claim, this further step. They ought to cast their lot with the rule. They ought to put their skin in the game as a requirement. Justice. Now, I hope I have persuaded you that there is something valuable in this. But as it's always the case in philosophy, there are always objections one can raise for the positions and the arguments that one puts forward. So here I want to mention four different objections that I've been able to think about against my proposal of equality of stakes, although in the end, I think they are not as devastating as, I mean, they're not too devastating to force us to entirely dismiss the idea of equality, the ideal of equality of stakes. So, to the first. The objection of adverse selection. This objection consists of the following. Look, if you do that, if you adopt a system of biotech responsibility requiring politicians to have that much skin in the game, all the well-educated, capable people who we want to be in a position of power to make good policies won't run for office. You would just have a problem of adverse selection. They would stay in the private sector pursuing comfortable lives, and they're not going to be willing to put their skin in the game. And that, unfortunately, is going to have the consequence that it's an objection against the instrumental argument. That's going to have the consequence that the quality of laws and policies is going to deteriorate, and justice is not going to be furthered. Now, as the other objection I mentioned about, politicians being making decisions too hastily, they have too much skin in the game. This one is inconclusive. There is a beautiful passage that I don't have here, but I'm going to tell it to you, by Tocqueville, who said, it's certainly important to have people in positions of power who have talents and virtues, but it is even more important that those in power do not have an interest contrary to the interest of the governed, because in that case, all those talents and virtues could become disastrous, because they would use them to further their own interest and not the interest. So what I'm saying here is that there's a trade-off here. Okay, yes, perhaps we would lose some expertise, to put it that way, from the policy-making process that we but in exchange, we would get individuals truly motivated to pursue the public good and to create a more just society. And I think that there are ways of incorporating expertise and expert judgment in policy making without the experts being the ones who are occupying public office. So, although this is a serious concern that one has to take into account, I don't think it is devastating to my proposal. So that is the objection of adverse selection. The second objection is, I call the objection of perverse incentives. The idea here is that in a system like this, in order to avoid the duties of pilotage responsibility or the duties of casting one's lot, politicians would have an incentive to privatize public services so that they don't have to actually make use of them, right? So this would create massive privatization of public services. Now, though interesting, I think this objection is not very worrying. Why? Because we could simply establish as part of this system that there are certain services and goods that a state ought to provide. There are some things that cannot be privatized. Or there are ways of getting around it if we think that privatization of certain services, schools for instance, might be overall good, then we can find ways of still having politicians equal stakes by, for instance, randomly appointing them to private schools. So they might end up going to a very low quality private school of the sort that the least advantaged members of society have no option but having to attend. So I think this objection can also be taken care of. A third objection is, I call, misplaced liability. And the idea here is, look, you're being very unfair to our poor politicians. You know, they're not responsible for everything. You know, they reach a position of power, but you know, government evolves, takes some time to, you know, the problems build up over time, and they're not responsible for past mistakes, and there might be, some people who really work hard in the government to create a just society, and just because others aren't doing the same thing, then you would force them to have subpar services, that would be unjust. My response to this objection is the following. equality of stakes is not a matter of corrective justice, of giving rulers what they deserve, right? It's not a matter of, okay, so you ruined public schools, then you're going to have to pay. It's not about that. It is about creating incentives through institutional arrangements of the sort I mentioned. And it is about accountability. It is about showing that what you did was the best that you could have done. So it's not a matter of matching, of, to put it in economics, in terms that are more familiar to economics, it is not a matter of them to internalize the costs of their mistakes. It's not about that. It is about social justice. Not corrective justice. Justice in the two senses I mentioned before. Incentives, having incentives to provide better services and owing it to the world to provide an account of their behavior. And finally, you might remember the system of pilot test responsibility. I established that not only public officials, but their dependents as well, would have to use public services. So there would be a prohibition, indeed, for public officials to send their kids to private schools. Now you can say, well, this is very unfair. They're not responsible for anything, right? It's not, I mean, their dependents. They're not the ones who are ruling or misruling the country. Why should they pay in any way? Well, again, it is not a matter of making anyone pay. And I think, so the response is the following. As parents, we can make decisions that affect the life chances of our dependents that are perfectly legitimate. So let me give you one example. Imagine a couple of doctors living in New York who are very prosperous, very wealthy, they're doing very well in their private practice. But one day, they just realize that this is an unjust world, and they want to do something about it. So they quit their private practices and decide to join Doctors Without Borders. Now, it turns out, they have two young kids. And by joining Doctors Without Borders and making the choice to establish a new life somewhere in Africa or South America, well, they would definitely be having an impact on the life chances, on the quality of life of their children. It is a fact. But no one here, I would say, I suppose, would say that that is an illegitimate choice. You're not required to pursue the most wealthy profession in order to provide the best schools for your children. You have to provide them the best you can for some minimal conditions, and I believe these couple of doctors could make an argument that certainly they would not be giving their kids the same opportunities as they would have as if they remained private doctors in New York, but they would still be offering a good enough life to their children. And that would be a legitimate choice to make. Well, I think the same applies to this case. Politicians, people authentically motivated under this scheme to create a more just society, would be making a similar choice. They would be accepting the responsibility of creating better conditions for everyone, and therefore for their own children, and they would be sending them to private, to public schools and providing them public health care services to them. So these are just some of the main objections I've been able to think about this scheme. And I hope I have convince you that they're not devastating, they're not too worrisome. so that we would have to discard entirely the idea of equality of states. Now let me say one last thing. Perhaps that very radical proposal I put forward, the idea of pilotage responsibility for randomly appointing public officials to public schools and hospitals and so on, that may be too radical. Perhaps that's why I say it was a pro-tempo argument. Perhaps there are less radical ways, institutionally speaking, to bring about the ideal of equality of interest that, with all things considered, would be justified. I leave that as an open question, something that I'm currently thinking about. It just depicts ideas. The radical proposal I put forward is one that conveys adequately what I have in mind with equality of states. So that's the last statement, and I conclude with this. There is much insatisfaction with the way in which modern democracy is working around the world. When you think about the image that ordinary people have about politicians, they think about very bad individuals, people who seek power for self-promotion, that they are willing to do very bad things at the cost of others. I believe this is true in service around the world. You know, the least well-regarded, among the least well-regarded professions was that of a politician. And in a way, I think that has to do with the fact that it's often true. And we think we have to think about ways to make democracy work better. We have to think about alternatives and proposals that would want people to have more trust in their own in their leaders, in those who rule over them, and their democratic institutions. So far, in democratic theory, political philosophers continue to be thinking about what is ultimately the justification of democracy. Democracy as we understand it today, elections with universal suffrage, we're stuck. I think we have to be moving forward in thinking, as it was done 200 years ago, of new institutional mechanisms to ensure that under democratic institutions, the lives of those who live there improve. So, thank you very much.
So I think rational self-interest and having skin in the game might ensure impartiality within particular sectors, but I'm uncertain if it will ensure partiality between particular sectors. Impartiality between sectors. So for example, who's the average politician? Here, white, straight, male, with children, adult-ish age, right? So if I'm a politician and I have to subject myself to the policies that I create, I'm prioritizing health. The entire world. Education gets nothing or little. Because my kids are educated, I'm getting older. So while impartiality might rank within a sector, and all hospitals are going to be equally as good because I don't know which one to go to, it might create partiality amongst the sectors. So I'm hoping that you might comment on that.
No, that's very good. I agree. And that's why I think this would have to be complemented with other kinds of institutional arrangements. So, well, first of all, whether that happens is just a matter of fact, right? It's an empirical practice of public office in a certain country are. So one way of dealing with this, for instance, would be by adopting institutions that create diversity at the level of decision making. So currently, as you know, well, in many countries there are proposals to make the decision making bodies diverse by establishing quotas of different types, or even more radically, some philosophers are proposing the idea of randomly appointing rulers to decision-making bodies, so we would do away with elections completely, and rulers would be randomly chosen from the population, so that the decision-making body would be an identical replica of society at large in terms of diversity. The same proportion of men and women in society would be present in the decision-making body, the same proportion of minorities, and so on. So in that way, you could deal with this problem. But I mean, I agree with you that it is a consideration that would have to, I mean, that would force any serious proposal to institutionalize this to think about devices to address that problem. Yeah.
I was thinking about if, let's say, you're a politician and you're making laws based on family and stuff like that.
Based on what?
Something dealing with like sending your kids to school, right? But you have no kids. If this was passed and how people got adopted to this idea, they would think, well, you have no right to make such a thing because you're not gonna suffer. You have no kids, so how can you make a law? It's nothing coming back to you. You have no stake in it because you have no kids. So what about stuff like that? So how would you include someone? Would that make them not able to make those kind of laws, or see what I'm saying?
I think it is somewhat similar,
right? I did have a similar idea with what he said.
I mean, his is slightly different. My concern is just unequally loading one. His concern is maybe the citizenry isn't going to think that you've got enough stake in the game to make it worthwhile. Like, how dare you make a decision about something that you don't know anything about, something that you can't deal with?
Right. So, it is impossible for politicians to have skin in the game in every decision they make, right? So that is not the idea. And I should have clarified. The idea of stakes is not, for instance, that we should make politicians sick so that they have to go to hospitals, or that we would force them to have kids to send them to school, or that we would force them, for instance, to be poor so that they have to use the
Right.
So the social safety net, for instance. So of course not. I mean, that would be to go too far. Now, so one response is, this is not a system that is guaranteed to create a perfectly just society. So it has limits, and among those limits, what you're saying and what you mentioned, but we can, it is that it would be an improvement because some people in office would have kids or grandkids that, well, perhaps this is more controversial, but the duties could travel across generations. So we have to be creative about the specific design that we would adopt to ensure this. But to the extent that there are these problems, so again, we don't want them we're not going to force them to be farmers so that they have to suffer the farming laws. It's just a matter of regarding the basic services and duties that the state ought to provide. they have to have, if they happen to be in the situation that they require the service, they have to face it as anyone else, right? So it wouldn't be, it's not a silver bullet against social injustice, but the point is that it would be a significant improvement, I think.
Thank you.
Have you considered a way of implementing this into practice?
Implementing this into practice? Well, like that.
I guess.
What do you mean?
You know, for instance, politicians need a lot of money to advertise to get into office. So, how would we still get the right people, and how would we get that law to be the name of the land when the elected people we have now would be the ones to have to accept this?
Right. So, again, I don't think this solves all the problems, not only of social justice in general, but political justice. So what I'm saying is, we still have to do many fixes to the traditional institutions of democracy, not only here in the United States, but in other places. The role of money in politics that you were pointing to is obviously a problem. And we have to take care of that independently of this. But let me just say that something like this, making politicians have a larger stake, would actually reduce the incentives they have to be responsive to special interests. For instance, the interests of people with corporations with a lot of money. And think about corruption in general. So, public official who has the possibility of taking a bribe that would, let's say, hurt the public school system would think about it twice under a system of equality of stakes if he has or she has kids that would have to go to those schools, right? So I think it contributes to, in a way, solving these other problems, but short answer is that we have to take care of those other problems independently. We have to give individuals the resources to ensure that their political rights are of equal value. It's not enough just to guarantee the formal liberty to participate, but we have to ensure that we all have the means to make an effective use of our formal political liberties. So we have to work on different tracks simultaneously to improve things.
So you say that you were in a way making the politician poor because you weren't forcing them to use the society's safety net or anything like that. But in a way, couldn't you also be disadvantaging the politician by randomly selecting a person of the society to pair with, if you pair them with somebody who's in poverty, who doesn't even have the option to go to the hospital in general and say yes? So would that not, I guess what I'm trying to say is, like, would that make them poor in a sense? Would that be too extreme, do you think?
The random appointment to public services, would that be a way of making them poor, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I mean, you said that if the piloted example, like randomly selecting them with anybody in the society, and obviously you have poor people in society who can't afford health care, would that be too extreme as far as making the politician not even go to a hospital if they got randomly selected to pair with somebody who's poor?
Oh, so you're saying in a system where politicians have eliminated public health care and there's only private health care?
No, I'm saying, because there's people in America who can't afford health insurance, so they wouldn't be able to go to a hospital if they got sick in general. So even if it was public, they wouldn't be able to afford to go anyways because they wouldn't be able to pay co-pays or anything like
I think among services and the goods, the resources that a state ought to provide to its population as a matter of justice involves healthcare. Of course, if you have a different conception of social justice, you would disagree with this. And you would, and your society with equality of states would look very different to my society with equality of states, but you could still endorse the idea. Now, so I would just say that there has to be, every citizen ought to have access to adequate healthcare. I mean, just period. And as a way of creating incentives for politicians to take a step in that direction, so perhaps they would be randomly appointed to the situation in which they don't even have it. Well, yes. I mean, I would be inclined to say yes. So this would be a step towards creating a more just society. So if you're really going to cast your lot with your subjects, then if you're going to be in the same boat, then yes. I mean, there are millions of people who cannot have access to healthcare, and if you're going to take seriously your responsibility to ensuring that that's no longer the case, then you would be, you could end up like one for them. So you better make sure that among the first things you do in office is ensure that those people, which could be you, right. Do have access to healthcare. So, perhaps, yes, so this would sound like too radical. But I think what is at stake morally in the exercise of power is very important. Right? Think about what is involved when you go to war. It's your life. You could, you know, it's very significant. It's what is at stake. And if we take seriously political power, then I think my answer would be yes.
Perhaps related to that, and I think it's related to your example of the brain surgeon, but perhaps a slightly different angle.
Mm-hmm.
There's one in my head I call the Eisenhower problem, right? General Eisenhower has to send 100,000 people to beaches on D-Day, knowing that 90% of them are going to be gunned down by machine fire before they reach the sand, right? If he's friends with all of them, he can't do it. Right, at some level, leadership seems to require a bit of detachment to say there's a bigger goal here, and even though some people are going to suffer in the process, there's a bigger end to be achieved. Mm-hmm. And might that be part of a counter argument against too much of equality of stakes?
Right. Let's say, Paul, I do believe that some public leaders face specific challenges that justify, at least for some time, them having some specific privileges or things that perhaps not everyone has access to. I mean, I'm not saying as a result of this proposal that we should eliminate the Secret Service, right? I mean, obviously the president of the country faces greater threats to her or his security that we have to deal with, right? We don't want our president to be killed every 2 weeks, right? At an election. Now that said, this would just last for some time while they're in office. That I'm proposing that they would eventually have to, like in Aristotle's famous conception, be ruling and being ruled in turn. But eventually, when they step out of office, and they would have to have skin in that sense. So I think something like that applies to the case of war. And so, well, traditional justice and very reasonable justification for not having those who wage war fighting is that, well, they are the leaders, they are making the strategy. So that makes sense, although at the same time it's very convenient, right, for them. So that's why I think, to the extent that this is a good reason not to have the president himself or herself go and be in the front line, I think there's a very good case to make sure that there's a draft and we have to reconsider military service and to make sure that perhaps his or her daughter, son or daughter, can be fighting that war. And in that case, again, I think they would be thinking about it twice, whether they would wage it or not. Whether it is really, truly a fight, a war worth fighting. That's very good. That's very interesting. I get this question a lot. Whether instead of, you know, no, which means it's a very good question, you know. If I understand you correctly, a different way of putting it is whether what I'm saying, is it not true that what I'm saying here leads me to, you know, saying that we should only have public schools, we should only have...
Yeah, the ultimate, like,
Exactly. Now, my response to that is that I think politicians have a special obligation by virtue of voluntarily taking on the responsibility of exercising such a tremendous power. And that places them in a special position that, for the reasons I mentioned, especially the non-instrumental argument on accountability, they have a duty to have skin in the game in a way that perhaps not all other citizens would have. So, I'm not saying that I would be completely against that kind of society as an ideal in some way. I mean, that is certainly kind of ideal society that some very important contemporary political philosophers imagined, for instance, Gerald Cohen. But since making the case for that, since that would be an even more radical kind of change, I want to keep it, you know, I want to argue for the minimum necessary at this point, you know what I'm saying? So I want to just say that politicians, by virtue of the position that they occupy, are in a special obligation to cast their lot with the rule in a way that perhaps not everyone else would be.
Thank you. Good, that was a long line for my question.
I understand we're talking philosophy and not practice here. So,
philosophy relevant to practice.
Right, but I want to try and frame my question as philosophically as possible, in the sense of, to use a trite phrase, who will watch the watchers, right? And not necessarily how you get this implemented in terms of the nuts and bolts, but is there a sense in which now you're going to have to set up some kind of hierarchy to enforce this. And so whoever's in charge of assigning the politician to a random public service may now be the one susceptible to corruption. And in a sense, you've replaced one non-ideal system with perhaps a different, but perhaps equally corruptible, not ideal system.
Right. Yeah, it's so unfortunate that the real world is so messy. You're right. We would have to think to prevent politicians from gaming the system. That's what you're talking about. And I think, you know, or hope that, you know, ordinary citizens would play a role in this, right? I mean, you can establish a system where citizens who spot politicians gaming the system by, you know, getting attended in private hospitals, not only in the country, but abroad. So perhaps they claim that they are going on vacation somewhere else, but what they're doing is actually getting health services abroad. And by the way, that's what many rulers, tyrants do, right? So, you know, I was talking to a guy, I don't know if he's from Egypt, he lives there, he was telling me about how many politicians there, you know, they don't care, of course, about state public hospitals because they fly to Europe all the time to get the best doctors. So, so you can establish, set up a system in which ordinary citizens would be rewarded monetarily or otherwise for spotting politicians gaming the system, along with severe sanctions for violations. So, I mean, of course, every system can be, to some extent, gamed. There's no perfect political system in any way, right? But we would just have to deal with those practical inconveniences as we currently deal with other practical inconveniences.
May I follow up?
Please.
In a sense, that seems to be back to the electoral accountability, though, right? That, well, you know, if you catch them gaming the system, you vote them out of office, you whatever.
No, you denounce them, and you, and there's a process. I mean, you would establish serious penalties for it. I mean, even in jail. So if you did not go to the hospital, you know, to a public hospital, where, you know, secretly getting this, and you get a serious punishment, I mean, perhaps jail or something, and to create an incentive for politicians, for ordinary citizens to be on the lookout, I mean, you can establish rewards, right? Like, just as we have it now, right? I mean, there are rewards for people who give information about some runaway criminals, something like that. Start with the latter. So this has nothing to do with socialism. You can have a perfectly capitalist society as the background economic system where this model would apply. So this is just a scheme of political responsibility. Now, I have been talking about certain kinds of services that I believe that the state ought to provide, right? Like public, like education and healthcare. But even if you disagree that the state ought to provide these services, let's say you don't think so, you can still buy into the proposal, right? So this is something that even a right-wing libertarian could accept. So for instance, a person who believes that we should have a minimal state, a state that is only responsible for protecting basic liberties and property rights. under that system, the main function of the state would be to create a rule of law to enforce rights, okay? So that would be the main service, the main duty of the state, its main duty of justice, right? So even then, what I'm saying is, since we know that the ideal of the equal protection of the law is not self-evident, right? You can have the same laws, but the extent to which the laws protect you depend on the quality of your lawyers. And there are very deep inequalities there. So if you think of that model of the minimal state, the ideal of equality of states would imply there that people should not be able to buy better legal representation than others. The state ought to provide the same protection of the laws to everyone. And that applies, and that involves that you cannot get a better result in court simply for the fact that you were able to pay for a better lawyer. We take the idea of equal protection of the law seriously, right? So in that society, there would be equality of states, and perhaps there would be these other inequalities in school, education, house, education, healthcare, and so on. But that's fine. So right now, you don't have to buy my conception of social justice in order to accept the ideal of equality of states, right? Now, so that's one point. And another point is that even if you accept my conception of the just society, where the state does have a responsibility of giving equal opportunities of everyone to have a flourishing life, which involves giving them access to adequate education and healthcare, that doesn't need to be a socialist society in any way. It can be a market economy where the state has, like here, right? Or think of Sweden or something like that. I mean, those are market economies where, nevertheless, the state is responsible for providing their citizens with certain goods. The first question, can you repeat that?
It's the freedom of choice. It is the people that like their politicians. So whatever they choose,
right.
They get it.
Right. So there are currently requirements for occupying public office that we don't think as illegitimate violations of freedom of choice, right? So in order to be candidate for the presidency of this country, you have to be of a certain age. You have to be a citizen of this country. And you have to have resided in this country for some period of time. You can't just go and vote for whomever you want. Now, we can discuss whether these are sensible propositions or not. But we don't really think they are. I mean, they're reasonable. And even if they aren't, I mean, there are constraints of freedom of choice that, you know, we don't feel very bothered about. So, it's part of the answer. Another part of the answer is that, sometimes it is possible for electorates to make mistakes. And if we know that there are certain things that we should avoid, and we can establish rules to prevent them, should avoid because they would create injustices, then limitations of freedom of choice would be justifiable. So suppose, for instance, what happens, consider, for instance, what happens in some European countries. There are no Nazi parties there. You cannot vote for the Nazi party. They're outlawed. And for good reasons, in my opinion. Right? So that's a restriction of freedom of choice. Why? Because we know that a government that is based on the idea that the ideals of the Nazi party would be an unacceptably unjust government. So we ban from office those individuals. of freedom of choice, yes, but justifiable on the basis of the principles of justice. So I would say something similar would apply in this case. Yes, you would only be allowed to vote for people who are willing to take the responsibilities and commitments of exercising political power seriously, in the sense of being willing to have enough skin in the game. So I think limitations of freedom of choice can be justified. Now, a variation of the argument that you're mentioning, which is interesting, I was thinking about this the other day. So someone can say, well, look, if this were really an important thing, if it really mattered that rulers had skin in the game, well, citizens in the first place would only be voting for politicians who, it would be a natural result, right? A natural equilibrium. People would be demanding them, and it would, they would be electing them. So the fact that we don't have any politicians making that kind of commitment, just proved that voters don't really care about it. Well, I think that's interesting. But I think there are responses to that. When debates on the extension of the right to vote for women took place, very few women were actually taking active part in that. But obviously, that is not a sign that the enfranchisement of women was not a requirement of social justice, right? There are many other reasons that explain why only a minority of women at the time were actively pursuing it. So something like that occurs here, I think, this is, I think, an innovative proposal, and perhaps the reason why voters, citizens in general, are mobilizing to demand it is perhaps because it hasn't occurred to them that we could establish something like that, right? So it's a twist on the question of freedom to choose that.